Only in that relationship with our Heavenly Father do we find everything that satisfies us, and so He is our great priority.
Welcome to Corinth Baptist Church Sunday Worship Services with Pastor Teacher Joey Carroll.
When pastors fall into sin, they gouge out the road of the gospel. If you're born again, and yet you are unrepentant in sin and unwilling to deal with sin in your life, you're gouging out the road to advance the gospel. I wanted to read you just a small section out of church history from the year 203, just a couple of centuries away from our Lord. And the reason being is, if you've ever had the opportunity of studying, particularly church history, you know it's cyclical. We have this way of repeating, unfortunately, oftentimes our mistakes. And in fact, I believe that we are repeating one now, and it's going to be the worst one ever in the history of the church, I believe, when it actually turns the corner and begins to play out. But I did want to take you to what was considered one of the most heroic times in the history of the church, when so many Christians were being martyred, and it was recorded for us in these early Christians' lives. And I want to take you to the account of five individuals who were not yet a part of the church. They did it a little bit differently back then. If you were a Gentile and you wanted to profess faith in Christ, you became a catechumen, and for 3 years they taught you the Word of God. At the end of the 3 years, if you still wanted to commit your life to Christ and come into the church, at that point they baptized you into the family. If you fell away at some point in those 3 years and set aside the Word of God or did not want to follow after God, you never made it to baptism and you never made it into the family. I'm not suggesting that's a good idea, but it's how they approach things. During this time, there were five individuals who were arrested by Rome as they were going through this 3-year process of studying the Word of God. 2 women and 3 men. One of the women's name was Perpetua, and she was a very well-to-do woman who was nursing a child. She had an infant child that she was nursing at the time. The other lady was a slave who also was expecting, had a child on the way, and then there were 3 other men. So let me pick up the account here, just a couple of paragraphs, nothing long. It said, when Perpetua and her companions were arrested, her father tried to persuade her to save her life by abandoning her faith. She replied to him, "Everything has a name, and it is useless to try to give it a different name." She said, "I have the name Christian, and that will not be changed." The judicial process was long and drawn out, apparently because the authorities hoped to persuade the accused to abandon their faith. Felicitas, the slave girl who had a baby on the way, was afraid that her life would be spared for that reason, or that her martyrdom would be postponed and she would not be able to die with her other 4 companions. But the historical account tells us that her prayers were answered and that in her 8th month she gave birth to a girl who was then immediately adopted by another Christian woman. Seeing her moan in childbirth, her jailers mocked her and asked how she expected to be able to face the beasts in the arena. They were scheduled to be killed by wild beasts in the arena. Her answer was typical of martyrdom of the day. She said, "Now, as I give birth, my suffering is only mine. But when I face the beasts, there will be another who will live in me and will suffer for me, since I shall be suffering for him." The first 3 men were brought into the arena, and 2 of them died quickly and bravely. But no beast would attack the 3rd young man. Some of them refused to come out to them, some of the animals, while others attacked the soldiers instead. Finally, Secundulus, who was the 3rd young man, declared that a leper would kill him, and then immediately a leopard came running onto the arena and killed Secundulus. Then they brought out the 2 young women, Perpetua and Felicitas, and they were placed in the arena first with a crazed cow. They struck them both, or the cow hit them both, and threw them to the ground. Perpetua asked at that time to be able to retie her hair. For loose hair, she said, was a sign of mourning, and this was a joyful day for her. Finally, the two bleeding women stood in the middle of the arena, bid each other farewell with a kiss of peace, and died by the sword. I read that not to strike you emotionally, but to say this statement. Shortly thereafter, for reasons that are not clear, persecution of the church stopped. And what's fascinating about that is it was 50 years of silence. No persecution. For some reason, God chose that moment to say enough. And in the year 249, almost 50 years, a king came over Rome whose name was Decius. Christians were excited because he was a very intelligent man, and so they thought there's not going to be any more of this crazed, barbaric war and killing to elevate their glory and their name. We have an intelligent man that's going to come in as king of Rome. But that backfired on them because Decius thought the reason Rome was falling apart was because they had stopped worshiping their former little g gods. And so Decius made the decision that every person in Rome would bow to these Roman gods and offer sacrifices and praise to them in order to restore Rome to its former glory. Decius was smart because he understood that in the first 200 years, blood of Christians had watered the ground and the church had grown like wildfire. Therefore, he was not going to martyr anyone. Rather, he was going to make them apostates. He was going to get the church to deny their faith through pressures or promises or persecutions or imprisonments, because he felt like apostates would not give them the glory of dying for Christ, which would only further encourage the growth of the church. The church, historically says, were very unprepared for this type of persecution. When they began to bring in Christians to Rome and begin to stand them before the authorities, many Christians fell and offered sacrifices and worship to God, little gods, to spare their lives, to spare their families, to spare their jobs, to spare their positions in the culture that they had created. Not only that, but you had to get a certificate that was called a libellum, and on it it said that you were okay. You had worshipped or offered to a false god, therefore you did not have to be persecuted. Well, just like today, back then somebody thought it wise to make out false certificates and sell false certificates that was falsely signed by Decius to say they're okay. So not only did many in the church bow to a false god, the other ones bought a lying certificate to say that they had, thinking that they would be okay because they didn't really do that, but it would be perceived that they did, and so that they would be okay with the church. There were a few, there's always a few, that came to be known as confessors. The confessors were those who refused to buy a lying certificate and refused to bow the knee and worship a false god. They hung to their confession of the Lord Jesus Christ, and they became the church. Now, there were so many in the church prior to this persecution because for 50 years, nobody had to die for their faith, so it was okay to come into the church and be a part of the church. But this new form of apostasy quickly divided the church and left them with but a handful of people called confessors that would not recant their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. The problem really came at the end of that persecution when those apostates wanted to come back inside the church. They didn't know what to do with them. Some churches said, well, sure, come on back in. Other churches would ask them, at what point did you want to come back to Christ? Did you want to come back while the persecution continued? Because they felt like they could stomach that a little bit better if somebody wanted to come back to Christ while the persecution continued. And so they felt okay to let them back in the church. But at any rate, it caused a great division of the church because they did not know what to do with all these stinking apostates. Let me offer you a thought. There has been 240 years of no real persecution in the country that you live in today. Not 50, 240. And in those 240 years, there has been a massive growth of the quote-unquote Christian church in America. And I would like to submit to you that it is chock full of apostates from one end to the other. There's apostates in the pulpit. There's apostates in elders and deacons. There's apostates in Sunday school teachers. There's apostates leading Vacation Bible School. The church is full of them, but there'll come a day when they will be weeded out of this church. I would like to say or offer to you, how do we deal with such as this? By preparing the church today for what is certainly going to come tomorrow. For 50 years, the church failed to prepare that next generation of how to deal with apostasy. For 240 years, as a whole, the church has failed to prepare the next generation for persecutions that will most certainly come and how not to be an apostate. We often talk about the glory days of old, and if you're older, I do not want to offend you, but oftentimes I hear older people say, oh, church back in the day. Well, let me say this. The church back in the day has made the church that you and I worship in today. And the church that you and I worship in today couldn't stand persecution from here to our mailbox before we would fold. That being said, it's all the more important for you and I to realize what we do today prepares the church for those children that are sitting in your laps now. We have an awesome responsibility to teach the Word of God to the people of God so that when this world continues to fall to the point where we begin to be persecuted, they will not be apostates and deny the faith or lie to try to say that they're still in the faith, but they will be confessors that will stand boldly upon their convictions in Christ and walk steadfastly and faithfully forward. You and I have that responsibility to be those kind of people and to raise and train and teach those kind of people. Our first persecutions will be light. It will be something similar to, we're going to take away your tax ID status so you can no longer get tax credit for tithing. And so preachers, in order to save their salaries, will do whatever necessary it takes and justify whatever they do so that they can continue getting paid to stand behind the pulpit. Churches will say and do whatever they can possibly do to save their huge buildings because they've paid so much for them, and in so doing, they will become apostates. It will affect us from one end to the other. And there will be a great division in the church of who is really real and who will hold to Christ to the death. Those days are ahead. So when we think about this and when we begin to dive into these scriptures, the writer of Hebrews is showing us there are two paths that you and I must take now. It is a path of obedience and righteousness, and there is a path of disobedience and unrighteousness. When we think about apostate, you need to think about a path. An apostate is a betrayer, right? Someone who turns their back. But you have to understand, until the time comes where they have to say yes or no, there is a long, drawn-out path that they pick, that they walk, that they take. And for those who wind up being confessors of the faith, there is a long, drawn-out path that they pick, that they walk, that they take. There's just two paths. You've got to get on the right one, and you've got to raise your family up on the right one. Because it's so easy to be on the wrong one and still come and do what we call church. That being said, I want to show you the paths that we find so often in Scripture. Look at Psalm 78. I don't have that up there for you. But I want to read to you just a few passages, and then we'll grab some other paths, and then we'll actually dive into the text. Psalm 78. Let's begin in verse 1. Listen, O my people, to my instruction. Incline your ears to the words of my mouth. In other words, turn your heart to God's word. I will open my mouth in a parable. I will utter dark sayings of old, which you have heard and known, and our fathers have told us. We will not conceal them from their children, but we will tell to the generation to come the praises of the Lord, of His strength and His wondrous works that He has done. For He has established a testimony in Jacob and appointed a law in Israel, which He commanded our fathers that they should teach them to their children, that the generation to come might know, even the children yet to be born, which is a reference to grandchildren, that they may arise and tell them to their children, that they should put their confidence in God and not forget the works of God, but keep His commandments and not be like their fathers, a stubborn and rebellious generation. Look at this. A generation that did not prepare its heart and whose spirit was not faithful to God. He's talking about and he's thinking about Deuteronomy 6 when he says, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. And then he goes on to say, Teach my word to your children. That's a responsibility that we have as a church. And it's a responsibility that you have as a dad, and it's a responsibility that we have as individuals to teach our kids there's two paths. There's two ways to walk in life. Pick the one that glorifies God. Turn to Psalm 1, head to the left. Steve pointed this out for us while he was here. Look at Psalm 1, and I'll just take you to one passage and look at verse 6. And you find this throughout Scripture. Psalm 1, verse 6 says, The Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish. There's just two ways. Turn to Proverbs, go to your right, one other passage, and then we'll get to the text. One book to your right, Proverbs chapter 4, and let me begin in verse 11. Again, we find two paths or two ways. Proverbs 4, verse 11. I have directed you in the way of wisdom. I have led you in upright paths. When you walk, your steps will not be impeded, and if you run, you will not stumble. Take hold of instruction. Do not let it go. Guard her, for she is your life. Notice the other path. Do not enter the path of the wicked. Do not proceed in the way of evil men. Avoid it. Do not pass by it. Turn away from it and pass on. That's our responsibility. And now you can go to Hebrews 10. That's our responsibility. And it's a very simple thought. I mean, it's A or it's B. This is not rocket science. This is not difficult, Dad, for you to lead your family spiritually, to be the spiritual head of the home. It's not hard. You've got the book. You just have to communicate it, and then you have to model it. That's the way you build confessors out of children and not apostates. If you want to make an apostate out of your kids, participate on Sunday in some shallow way and don't engage your family spiritually at all the rest of the week. And you will make die-hard apostates. They will look good on the outside, but on the inside, when they're tried, they'll fold. I want to say more, but let's go to the text. Hebrews chapter 10. He begins to walk us. First, he takes us down the good way, the right way. And he begins to talk about three things that are, I don't want to say necessary, three things that are characteristic of a child of God, of a confessor. These things are absolutely certain to find them in their lives. Then, we won't get there, then he walks through a long section of what an apostate looks like. And by the way, an apostate is not a straw man. It's not a hypothetical situation that's not real. There is a situation where somebody confesses Christ, we dunk them, we sprinkle them, whatever you want to do, and then when they finally get tested, they walk out on God. There is such a situation. Okay? It's very clear in Scripture. The reason we don't know is because they haven't been tested. All right? He leaves that and he goes right back to the church and he says, but I know you're here on the good way. And then he encourages them. That's where we'll wind up. So let's spend what time we have left this morning on talking about this way that we need to be walking in, that we need to be training our kids in, that we need to be doing. Look at verse 19. Therefore, everything that I've said since chapter 1, here's our response. Let us. And he goes into three things we actually need to be doing. Therefore, you need to be continually doing these three things to walk on a path that takes you toward faithfulness to God. But let me back up. He makes two other statements before he gets to that instruction. Therefore, brethren, since we have, here's number one, here's number two. It's really hard to write with a pen, even though I write sloppy anyway with this thing. There's two things that it builds a foundation for the three things that you need to be doing. The first thing is, brothers, we have blood. We have a sacrifice. And it was the sacrifice of our Savior. Based on this realization, he's going to take you to three things that need to be done in your life. But we also have more than a sacrifice. We have a great high priest. And I've spent the last five chapters, he says, talking about the sacrifice of Christ and the priesthood of Christ, okay? So you have these two sacrifices. I mean, you have these two things, a sacrifice and a priesthood, and look what they have given you. Therefore, brethren, since we have confidence to enter the holy place by the sacrifice of the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way, which he inaugurated for us through the veil, that is his flesh, and since we have a great high priest over the house of God, look what he has given us through these two things. The holy place, where God is. Through the veil, where God is. Into the house of God, where God is. Based on these two things, he says, you have a, look at this, a living way to God. You have a path. You have a road to take. And Christ paved that road for you and put lines to lead you in the direction of God. He was so careful to draw a line out and say, this is the way of righteousness. This is the way you need to take. Now walk in it. Now I know that when our kids leave home, and I got one leaving shortly, we all want them to take a particular way, do we not? Well, let me tell you something. If you wait too long to paint the lines in the road for them, they're probably not going to take that way. You start painting those lines when you're in Brandy's condition and you know it, it's on the way. Or Melissa's, it'll be here in 2 weeks. Chris, you paint lines now. I love what Tyler said this morning when we prayed for each other. Tyler said, y'all pray for me that I will figure out how to communicate the Word of God to my newborn infant. Yes! He gets it. That's when you begin painting lines in a road away to God so they'll understand about the way and walk in the way. And you say, well, I'm late coming to the game. That's not fair. Okay. Recoup as much as you can. Do as much as you can. Have the conversation. I've made a mistake. I've not always painted a clear path for you. I've not always set an example for you. Please forgive me. But you need to know there's only one way to take. There's only one way to walk. And now I am trying desperately to walk that way. Please follow me. I know you're older. I know you got your own life, but please follow me in this way. Please walk after me. It's not a hopeless situation. If you're a grandparent, you get to start over. You sit your grandkid on your knee and go, there's a way you have to take in life. There's only two. Let me tell you about the right one. And you pour into their lives this particular way. And you help their parents paint that road for them, so that even your grandkids would walk in the way. Remember Psalm 78? To a children that's not born yet. It's a reference to a grandchild. You can paint a way for them. This is never hopeless. Okay, so we've got all that. Now let's get to our three things. Oh, man. Y'all going to have to tell me what time it is, or I'll be up here all day. All right. Let us draw near with a sincere heart in full assurance of faith, in verse 22, having our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. That's the first one. I'm thinking that's all we're going to get to deal with today. Second one, let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. Let us consider how to stimulate one another to love and good deeds, not forsaking our own assembling together. So there's three things here, right? Let us walk in faith. Let us walk in hope. Let us walk in love. Wow. Sounds just like something Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians 13, don't it? Faith, hope, and love. And you know what? Those are not mystical terms. They're not esoteric, obscure words that are religious. They're very practical and very definable. We just struggle to define them. We ought to be able to talk to somebody about faith. We ought to be able to talk to somebody about hope. We ought to be able to talk to somebody about love. And they ought to look at us and go, I know what you're talking about. I don't have that. But these are the three things, because of the sacrifice of Christ and the priestly ministry of Christ, these things define who we are. I'm a person of faith. I'm a person of hope. And by all means, I am a person of love. Okay? Now, it gets very practical. Let's talk about this. This is a term for worship. Old Testament term, Leviticus chapter 1. When you drew near to God in worship, you brought a sacrifice. The sacrifice is to make atonement for your sin so you could even worship God. Okay? So he's stealing an Old Testament thought and he's saying, we need to draw near in worship. Now, the first question, let me go here first. The first thought is, how do we worship? Let me give you some ideas here. Prayer. Song. Giving. Tithing. The Word. Lord's Supper. These are the five big ones that we do while we're together. All of these are expressions of worship. We worship God when we began, when three men led us in prayer. We worship God in song when Barbara led us in song. We're worshiping God now as we turn to God in His Word. We were worshiping God when you took the check or whatever out of your pocket and dropped it in the offering plate. Next Sunday, Lord willing, we will worship God when we participate in the Lord's Supper. Now the question is, how often do we need to do these things? And he said that in the first word, because in the first word in the Greek is let us, and it's in the present tense. It means you need to consistently and continually need to be drawing near to God in worship. This is not something you do on Sunday morning. Your life is to be modeled and patterned by worship. It's a characteristic of a child of God. Let me ask you, did you worship God before you got here this morning? Hopefully you did. Every time you turn to Him in prayer, you're worshiping Him. Every time you open up His book, you're worshiping Him. Every time you put a song on your phone to listen to while you're getting ready or ironing clothes, you're worshiping Him. It is a continual habit to worship God. Let us draw near. Now, he goes on to say there is a particular way to do this. With a sincere heart. Does that convict anybody? You ever bowed your head in prayer while these three guys were praying and then you had no clue what they said? Not because you couldn't hear, but just because you were checked out. That's a lack of sincerity. You ever come in here for song and did this right here while they were singing? That's insincere worship. You ever wanted to give and offer something to God financially and you begrudgingly did it? Whatever. That's insincere worship. Have you ever checked out while I'm preaching the Word? I check out sometimes too, don't I? Sincerity is when God has our absolute attention and focus. And we struggle. We all struggle with this. Come on, wake up, preacher. I have to do that sometimes while we're singing because I'm thinking about the announcements. God don't care about announcements. He just wants to be worshiped. Wake up, preacher, sing. Pay attention to the words. Because it's funny, I'll say the wrong word sometimes and whoever I'm sitting by will look at me like, where'd you get that word? God wants us to continually worship Him sincerely from our hearts. This passage teaches us so much about worship. You know why we can worship? Look at this. Sprinkled clean and our bodies washed with pure water. Look at that. You know why you can? Because you're clean. You know you couldn't before you'd bathed? I can't stand it when people come in the drugstore and they hadn't had a bath. We have a can of Lysol sitting behind the pharmacy counter just for those special occasions when people come in summer and they hadn't had a bath in like a week. So as soon as they leave, you know, we're just walking through the store, you know. Do you know that you couldn't even come in the presence of God and worship Him rightfully until Jesus shed His blood for you and sprinkled you and cleansed you? And now when you come into the presence of God, you don't stink. There's no sin. It's been paid. And so you're clean. You got your bright whites on, and you can stand before Him in sincerity of heart while you sing, while you pray, while you give, while you listen to this preacher, and when you take Lord's communion. Those are just some ways, but those are the primary ways. You can do that because you've had a bath through the blood of Christ, and it's pleasing to God, and you can come in full sincerity and worship. That's a good thing. It's such a good thing that the writer of Hebrews says, if you want to get on the right path, this needs to be something you're doing all the time. It needs to be the highlight of your day. What are you going to do tomorrow? Chris asked me, and I said nothing. That's a dumb answer. I'm going to worship God. I don't know when. Hopefully right when I wake up, the house will be quiet, and I'm going to engage in worship. First thing I'm going to do, I can't wait. I'm going to engage God in worship. That's the way we need to be. Don't ever let it be said, what are you going to do tomorrow? I don't know. Going to work, I guess. Well, yeah, you might, but you can worship too. Something needs to be about our lives. Now, there is one thing. What time is it? Really, honestly, somebody tell me what time it is. Okay, I got to hurry. I forgot my watch. There is something that hinders us. And this teaches us two things about sin. I'm going to try to write depravity. That does not look good. And I'm going to try to write inner man. Write those two down. Write these two things down. All right. Look at this. This is going to teach us something about the doctrine of sin while he's teaching us something about worship. And this is awesome. Look at this. Having our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience. Look at those two words. Now, the first thought is, I want to turn to evil, and then we'll come back to those two words. Do you think yourself is evil? That's not a really good word to describe somebody. Can you tell me a little bit about yourself? Well, I'm evil. That's an honest reply. For a Christian. But you're going to get a funny response when you say that. But it is true, according to the words of our Lord Jesus. Out of our heart come all sort of evil and wicked things. But we don't think like that, right? Because when I talk about evil, you're going to think about, well, I saw a guy on the news, he killed so-and-so, and he did this, and he did that, and now that guy's pure evil. That's what we say, right? We look at external things. And we don't look at where the problem lies. The reason that we look at a person and go, now that person's pure evil, that's because I'm comparing myself to another human being. It doesn't work like that. I'm evil because God compares me to Christ, who is not. He is holy. That's why I'm evil, okay? That's why the Scripture refers to you. Are there people that do worse things than you? Sure there are. All the time. But that doesn't change who you are. You're in comparison to Christ. Remember who you're worshiping, who you're coming before. You're coming before God. Hello, God, I'm here. But I'm nothing like you. You're holy. I'm evil. So it teaches us something about sin. Sin is ugly. And it's not just the things that we do, because we don't want our kids to go off to school or go off with weird people and do things we don't want them to do. Is that a problem? Yeah, but it's not the real problem, because the real problem lies here in their hearts and in their conscience. The second thought about sin is it's a heart problem. Not only is it an evil problem, it is an inner problem. That is the greatest problem. And if I can say one thing about the church of yesterday, critically, I should have said three positives before I draw one critical, but let me make one critical statement about it. They focused on external sin. And they did not teach the church about internal sin. They taught people about morals. You know, I know we're running long, I'm sorry. I know I was standing on the football field, or I was standing up in the stands the other day watching John practice football. And I heard the ugliest word that you could possibly think of yelled out by one of the kids, and I heard it through the whole stadium.
You know what those coaches did? Kept right on talking. Now, when I was a boy, when a kid yelled out a cuss word, oh my, you ran till you puked, or you went home and you told your mom and dad what you said, and after they beat you, the coach would decide if you could play. I'm talking about coaches who never darkened the door of a church did that. The church of yesterday pressed morality. Talk right, do right, live right. Well, you can do that all day long, but you'll still wind up in hell talking right, living right, and doing right. Because the problem with sin is it's who we are. It's the nature of who we are. It takes a lot more than good behavior to make it into heaven. It takes a Savior and a Son to die, to wash me on the inside. We're way out of the age of morality. Morals are gone. You can be a 12-year-old kid and shout cuss words on the football field. Nobody really cares. Because your parents will be shouting them from the stands, typically. We're out of the age of morality. I'd rather be in the age of morality. But let me tell you something, what we can really see now, we really see sin for what it is. It's a problem with the heart. And in order for you to worship God, Jesus had to die and shed His blood to clean your evil heart. And if He's done that, you can draw near to Him in worship. Let's stop there. Let me challenge you with some things, because the word faith is going to take us a long time. We'll talk about that next week. This is what we have, church. Let me bring it into a close. And I'm not looking for some momentary emotional reaction. I'm trying to engage you in prolonged thought. God set aside a group of people, and only those group of people can worship Him. Everybody can. Those people that He set aside, He washed with the blood of His Son. He cleaned them from the inside out. And then He calls them to Himself to continually offer up worship to Him. We can literally worship God in almost everything that we do. And we can do it sincerely. I want you to reflect on these things this week. I want you to be thankful for these things this week. And when we roll back in here together, whether that's next week or Wednesday, I want you to come in here realizing I've been a set aside to worship God. And come in here with hearts filled with praise and joy, lifting up voices in worship. Okay? Let's pray.